Hi there, and welcome back to the second half hour of KARE 11 News at Noon. We're so glad that you can be here with us. A lot of great things to tell you about over the next 30 minutes, including saving money on home projects. We all could use a little bit of that. And we have developing stories like the escalating tensions at college campuses nationwide. But first, let's go ahead and get a look at the weather with Ben. It's beautiful out there right now,
yeah,
at least.
Yeah, it is right now. We do expect there to be a little thunder and lightning later on today and maybe some borderline severe weather around the Twin Cities, but a better chance further south and southwest, especially along the I-90 corridor. Let's show you radar and satellite right now. Things are, again, rather quiet right now, but the clouds are just starting to increase. A couple of showers that are just north of the Redwood Falls area are actually fizzling. More thunder, more organized thunder over parts of Iowa, but the main front is still hanging back here towards the Sioux Falls area. Whatever forms of that later today is going to push into our neck of the woods. Do plan on wet conditions as we head into the evening commute, with a better chance for thunder as we get closer to the sundown time frame, especially I'd say after 6-7 o'clock. That's going to be our window here in east central Minnesota. Here's your hour by hour forecast. Temperatures grazing near 70 by this afternoon, depending on how much sunshine we see, and you can see rain chances return I'd say after 3:30, after 4 o'clock. That's when we'll start to see the initial rain show up and a better chance for thunder as we head deeper into the evening. As far as severe weather potential goes, the best chance, areas in yellow. That's a slight risk for severe weather. On a severity scale, it's a 2 out of 5, and then includes areas like Laverne, Marshall, Jackson, the Mankato area, and just outside of Rochester. Twin Cities right now in a marginal risk for severe weather. We will time out the rainfall this evening and talk more about when more 70s are in the forecast. That's coming up. Alexis?
Ben, thank you. And with just days until finals, a dozen of the U of M's buildings are closed, including the library, as pro-Palestinian demonstrations continue to grow. Cece, you've gotten a chance to see what some of those demands are that the organizers are setting out. What did you find?
Yeah, for sure, Alexis. So right now, there's a new permanent encampment on Northrop Mall, and student organizers say the encampment will stay until the university meets 6 specific demands. So here they are. So the first is to divest from all companies involved in war crimes, genocide, and human rights violations. Also, ban Lockheed Martin, Honeywell, General Dynamics, and others from hosting workshops and recruiting on campus. They also want a complete academic divestment from militarized Israeli institutions that are currently aiding the ongoing genocide in Gaza. Complete transparency about university investments and spending, and to release a statement in support of the U's Palestinian student body, and pardons for all on campus involved in the movement for Palestinian liberation.
We tried all the right channels that they put for us, and they ignored it for 7 months. So I feel like now they see us, I guess, or like now they hear us.
I don't really care that they're protesting. They have a right to do that. That's not an issue with me. It's literally just the fact that they closed the library.
So the U says today is already a designated study day, so the closures won't really affect classes, but it'll be interesting to see how the U responds to this.
Absolutely, especially since this is not the only place we're seeing
right.
This. Across the country, we're seeing a new level of protests, including buildings being broken into and students being suspended. Still, protests are growing. At Columbia University, students barricaded themselves in a building as officials tried to break up their efforts. The school now says protesters must sign a form promising to abide by school policy or face punishments. We're following a significant police shooting out of North Carolina, where today 4 officers are dead and others are hurt. NBC's Sam Brock takes us to the scene where it all happened.
In Charlotte this morning, a deep sense of loss following one of the worst attacks on law enforcement in recent memory.
Headquarters, we got shots fired.
A shootout taking the lives of 4 law enforcement officers and leaving 4 others wounded. Overnight, Charlotte-Mecklenburg's police chief announcing one of his own officers, Joshua Iyer, died as a result of that attack, leaving behind a wife and 3-year-old son.
We'll always be indebted to Officer Iyer for his bravery and his sacrifice for this profession.
Police say the shooting erupted outside of this home, captured in chilling detail on a live stream. Members of the U.S. Marshals Fugitive Task Force attempting to serve a warrant on a convicted felon wanted for firearms possession quickly found themselves taking on heavy gunfire.
Officers returned gunfire and struck the victim, who was later pronounced deceased in the front yard of the residence.
The chief says a second person then fired on the officers from inside the home.
Target down. Additional shots from inside the house.
Video taken by a neighbor shows law enforcement, including SWAT teams, descending on the scene as residents looked on in shock.
I heard like gunshots, and then that's when the police were telling everybody to like stay in their house.
After a three-hour standoff, police cleared the home, finding a woman and a 17-year-old inside.
They were both brought to the police station as persons of interest.
Authorities say the other victims include a deputy with the U.S. Marshals and two members of the state's Department of Correction, identified overnight as Sam Peloche and Alden Elliott, both 14-year veterans of the department.
We lost some heroes that are out to just simply trying to keep our community safe.
Charlotte's mayor fighting back tears.
And the most that I can ask of our community is that we honor and respect them.
Former President Donald Trump is being fined thousands of dollars after a judge found him in contempt of court. It's all linked to repeated violations of a gag order stopping him from talking publicly about the ongoing New York hush money trial. The judge found nine violations coming out to $9,000 in fees. Trump insists he is exercising his freedom of speech. Well, in just minutes, we're expecting to hear the latest in the case against the man accused of killing his ex-girlfriend, Maddie Kingsbury. Adam Fratible is charged with the murder of Kingsbury, the mother of his children, in March of last year. Today, his attorneys are seeking to change the trial venue and claiming an impartial trial would be impossible in Winona County, given the media coverage of the case and extensive volunteer search efforts. His attorneys are also seeking to have a first-degree murder charge dropped. We're taking a live look at the nation's capital, where Minneapolis Mayor Jacob Frey will be for the next few days. He's one of several mayors from around the country lobbying for more homelessness response funding at all levels of government. Frey is expected to meet with the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, top White House officials, and other state representatives as they call for federal officials to invest in housing solutions.
Well, just into our newsroom, we're learning a highly toxic chemical known to cause cancer has officially been banned. The Environmental Protection Agency finalized a rule to end the use of methylene chloride. It's most commonly found in paint strippers and can be dangerous if inhaled or touched. The EPA says consumer use will be phased out over the next year. And consider this. It's reported that the equivalent of one garbage truck full of clothes is burned or dumped in a landfill every second. And many times it's cheap disposable clothing that's ending up in those dumps. Clothing that's part of a fast-growing trend called fast fashion. Tonight at 10, a closer look at what's fueling this trend, its hidden costs, and the rise of some unique efforts to counter it.
Well, if you're headed out this evening, you're going to want to bring your raincoat and rain gear. Ben, we're tracking some of those storm chances. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't be spring without some of these storms.
Yeah, absolutely. And this, for many of us, including here in the Twin Cities, is going to be our first real chance at seeing some severe thunderstorms. First opportunity this season. So it's something we have yet to see so far this spring. Now let's take a look at a broader approach to where we expect the severe weather to be. That's the areas down in Iowa. That's kind of the bullseye once again. That's where we have an enhanced risk for severe weather. But notice we still have that yellow shaded area. That's a slight risk for severe weather. That has expanded to include parts of southeastern Minnesota, including areas just outside of Rochester. You can see the severity level goes down the further north you go, including here in the Twin Cities Metro. But we expect storms to develop in this area in southwest Minnesota within the next few hours. And then those will traverse eastward as we get deeper into the afternoon and into the evening. But this is a more detailed look at our specific severe weather threats. Best risk for tornadoes, that's in southwest Minnesota, but I'm thinking the best chance for severe weather, the best detailed look is a hail and elevated wind outlook. So southwest Minnesota, that's where the storms will initiate, and then they'll propagate eastward as we get deeper into the afternoon and the evening. This is a live look at radar. We're seeing some of that filtered sunshine right now. A few dissipating showers outside the Gaylord area right now. We are expected to see more sunshine as the day progresses, but there's the main front right here. Mostly non-severe stuff that's happening in west central Iowa right now, but what we expect is those thunderstorms to kind of form along that front before pushing eastward later in the day today. This is microcast that, again, will show those clouds continuing to increase later today. The storms initiate, I'd say, by 2, 3 o'clock this afternoon. There they are, and you can see as we head deeper into the afternoon, they kind of congeal and form this main line. And this timing right here, I'd say between about 4 and 6 o'clock is kind of the window where the best chance for severe weather arrives. And that's where the thunderstorms are. Minnesota River Valley, southwestern part of the state, still outside the Twin Cities metro area. But notice as that main line pushes into our part of the state, should be less severe by this point, but still some heavy rain, lots of lightning, maybe some small hail and some gusty winds on the leading edge of this. That would be a little closer to sundown. So the deeper into the evening we go, the better your chances at seeing some of those thunderstorms. This is a pretty quick moving event. Notice by 10 o'clock, everything exits Minnesota and pushes into Wisconsin. And we are looking at drier weather for the 1st of May, which, by the way, is tomorrow. So enjoy the filtered sunshine while we have it. Clouds will continue to increase with some afternoon and early evening thunderstorms. Temperatures peaking near 70 today. That's system number one. We get a break in the action on Wednesday. And then as we head into Thursday, May 2nd, here comes system number two, bringing us increasing rain chances, especially as we head into Thursday, midday into the afternoon. Looks fairly wet and maybe a chance for a few rumbles of thunder as well. Your 7-day forecast shows a rain chance about every other day, a cooling trend as we head closer to the weekend, maybe a few showers heading into Saturday, but a brighter day is in the forecast on Sunday. Lots of sun will get us back up near 70 degrees, a little warmer than average heading into early next week with more 70s back in the forecast next Monday and Tuesday. Alexis?